My name is Emin Günserer. I am a professor at Cornell University of Computer Science, and I'm also the CEO of Ava Labs, which is a new company that I started, building on this technology called Avalanche, building a new coin, a mainnet called Ava. I'm also the co-founder of Bloxroute, which is another company which is looking at layer zero, the networking layer of cryptocurrencies. So I was a young assistant professor at the time, and peer-to-peer systems were just becoming big. We had just seen Napster, LimeWire, and Kazaa. These networks were coming online. And in any peer-to-peer system, you always have this problem where the participants try to take resources without contributing resources. It's like the problems we have with society at large. We'll know that BitTorrent is based on tit for tat. I give you a block in return for a block you give me. That's okay when two people want the same things, but it's very hard to make work if people don't all want the same thing. So my approach was, well, why don't we use money? Money is a great way of storing some record of somebody having been good. You earn it as you work, and then you spend it as you need to consume resources. But of course, it's a peer-to-peer system, and you couldn't possibly have a central entity issuing the money. So we invented this system called Karma, where there was no central mint. The minting was done in a distributed fashion, and it led to these tokens that are used for downloading and uploading resources. So it was 9/11/2001 had just happened, and in the US at least, everybody was very, very concerned about terrorist financing. And there was this concern that these peer-to-peer money kind of systems could be abused. And I was told in no uncertain terms that I should not work on this, that there would be no funding for it, and that it wouldn't go anywhere as a result, as part of the career of a young assistant professor. So I built Karma, but we did not push it. Satoshi came 5 years later, at a far better time, right after the 2008 crash, and he did very, very well. He also had an additional breakthrough that we did not have. So he had some additional technical ideas on top of ours, so that was good. So when I saw the paper, I was first intrigued, looked into what was being said, and I thought about very hard about what was proven and what was sort of aspirational, what were ideas that Satoshi wanted to have happen, but it wasn't clear if he really ascertained them, if he really made them happen. And one of my next pieces of work in that line in the cryptocurrency world was to look at Satoshi's protocol and to notice that there was a big gaping hole. So with Itai Eyal and myself, we came up with this thing known as selfish mining. And in selfish mining, our breakthrough was to say, look, the protocol that Satoshi gave you is interesting, it's got some great features, but it is not as secure as everybody says it is. It is not as secure as what Satoshi says it is. And you can follow what he says and you'll be doing okay, but I can give you an alternative technique, an alternative strategy for mining, where if you were to follow that, you will make more money. That's called selfish mining. And it caught the world by surprise because everybody had been repeating this line that Bitcoin is safe as long as the majority is honest. And we proved that that's not sufficient. Majority has to be honest. But in fact, a supermajority has to be honest. About 75% of the hash rate has to be honest. Yeah. Sure, so in our study, we found that both Bitcoin and Ethereum are quite centralized, despite the attention paid to decentralization. It turns out that the vast majority, the bulk of the Bitcoin blockchain, is produced by 19 mining pools. And the same number for Ethereum is just 11. The amount of effort that goes into trying to get decentralization and the actual decentralization that's achieved are very, very small. Yes, the Avalanche protocol that we're working on is one that's, that has some interesting properties. I believe it to be the third big breakthrough in the space of consensus protocols. It is very, very robust, and it's incredibly decentralized. It allows anybody to participate in the network, anybody with stake to participate in the network. Right, I'm one of the co-directors of this thing called IC3. It's the Initiative for Cryptocurrencies and Smart Contracts.
Yeah.
It is the biggest academic consortium of its kind, looking broadly at blockchain technologies, and it includes 8 different universities. So not just Cornell University, which has a lot of people working on blockchains, but also Berkeley, Illinois, UIUC, Cornell Tech, EPFL in Switzerland, ETH Zurich, University College London, and the Technion in Israel. So there are a couple of long-standing problems with blockchains. Number one is they don't scale. Number two is they're not secure. Number three is they're very hard to govern and control. And we've had 10 years of the current technology, and in those 10 years, we've made almost no progress at attacking any of these problems. Of course, we're going to have people who take an existing solution, slightly reparameterize it, tweak a couple of numbers here and there. So you have Bitcoin and you have Litecoin, right? It's just a few numbers changed. It's the same technology, and those numbers that were changed make no difference whatsoever. So these copycat technologies have brought us nothing. Very, very few people are doing the hard work of actually looking at addressing these issues. So scalability is something that my group is looking at very, very directly with the Avalanche protocol and the AVA mainnet. We want to address what happens at the scalability level. Security is a long-standing problem. The security problems stem from two things. One, the people who build coins. We're building AVA, and my colleagues are building, Bitcoin, Ethereum, etc. Almost every group other than ours is externalizing the security problem. They think it's someone else's problem. The coin does what the coin does. And then, a security problem with your phone is your phone's problem. A security problem with an exchange is the exchange's problem. And they just don't pay any attention. And they hope that, that technology for building servers, for building phones and so forth, is going to improve. That people will use their phones responsibly. They won't put rogue applications on top. People will administer their servers and exchanges well. So that's a big shortcoming. And we found that these platforms don't improve. And in AVA, one of the things we're doing is we take security very seriously, and we want to build remedies into the coin. We know this other software is not going to be secure. We know there will be thefts, and we would like to ensure that there is some technology to recover from the theft in certain cases without having to go to courts and so forth. There are technical measures so that other people are not able to steal your coins. So that's one of the things we're doing. The other thing, of course, is that people are using centralized exchanges. So we have this fantastic new technology. It relies on trustlessness. It doesn't require trust from anybody. And then what do people do? They purchase these coins, and then they put them in centralized exchanges where they trust the exchange. And of course, then there's all sorts of moral hazard. People disappear. They go to India. Nobody knows exactly what happened over there. Very, very questionable situation and so forth. So the problem there, the fundamental issue there is the presence of a trusted counterparty. So we're looking at things like decentralized exchanges to try to get rid of the presence of such centralized counterparties. I think the coin and the ecosystem should provide all of the required tooling for the safe exchange of the coin. So the blockchain trilemma is something about how you can't have decentralization, security, and something else all at the same time. It's complete bogus stuff. There's like nothing, no substance to that statement. It's true for proof of work. So within the proof of work context, yes, there is such a trade-off. But there are many other protocols possible. And if anybody ever cites the blockchain trilemma, it just shows that they don't understand the big picture. They don't have a good grasp of the general space. And so far, the visit to Korea has been absolutely fantastic. I found, just as I expected, a ginormous market. There are a lot of people here who are really excited about the technology, who are cognizant about the technology, who really are excited about it. But at the same time, it has the feeling of a small community. It's a big community, a powerful community, but it isn't really all that out of control and sort of hard to grasp. The number of active actors in it seems to be, the players in it seems to be somewhat small. So we met with some people yesterday that left me feeling like this is a very, very sort of dynamic, energized town with a lot of people who understand the technology. And anytime I'm in such an environment as a techie myself, I get very excited. So it's been a wonderful trip so far. So my role in this industry has been constant. Even though I've played, I do a bunch of different things. I'm a professor, I'm a founder, I'm an entrepreneur at the same time. My role has always been the same. I am the science-based science-driven person who was not afraid to call out when other people are feeding bogus things to the masses, whose decisions are always, as much as I can make them, based on good principled reasons. That has been the one distinguishing feature. When I tweet, I always think, is this correct? I'm not here to sort of wave a banner. If there's a problem with Ava, I'll be the first person to call out the problem with Ava. So let's see. So that's, I think, what sets my approach apart from everyone else. It has served me very, very well. So I've been around, this space for a long time. I've said, thousands and tens of thousands of tweets of material. And, there have been some predictions I've made based on good scientific reasoning that didn't happen. But other than that, I don't think I've ever said anything that was incorrect, that is blatantly false or has actually turned out to be a bad thing to say. So that's a very good track record. I think I'm one of the people with probably one of the best track records around in terms of calling out the scientific truths.